Okay, so welcome back. First of all, welcome Phil Baker, Tony Hill. I'm picking up from Rorty, who can be summarised from Richard saying, he said that what you see depends on where you stand. And there were many of us who were thinking about Phil very hard over the last 30, 40 years, maybe even longer, who thought that standing in Hollywood, you only saw one kind of film, and there was this whole apparatus that if you stood somewhere else, you could see it another way. One of the pioneers of standing somewhere else was Tony Hill, and I'm very privileged to have him here. One of the locus for that standing somewhere else was the London Film Co-op, and it's just reminded me that this is almost like coming home, because the London Film Co-op was more or less like this. So, where you're standing is where you stood 40 years ago. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Actually, the first piece I'm going to do was the first done 41 years ago. So. Okay, I'll just give a little bit more background. I started training as an architect, and then I realised it wasn't going to be for me. Too many regulations, no room for experiment, I felt, and no hands-on as well. That was the reason why I sort of moved away from that. And then I studied fine art, sculpture, and I started to use film as a sculptural medium. And I made floor films. I made a number of films projected on the screen on the floor, and you stood on the screen to watch the film. So that was my sort of beginning for film, really, making films that were going on the floor, and you went in this room with dark walls, and the whole floor area was the screen. So really it was related to projection as a kind of sculptural event. You know, that was one of my fascinations with you being able to use film, was the fact that you projected. And that's a kind of sculptural event that's happening. In the early 70s, filmmakers in America here were experimenting with different forms of projection. So projection became one of the ways of kind of undermining that sort of cinema Hollywood thing a little bit. The term expanded cinema was introduced and came to be applied to this kind of work. And I made some multi-screen work. In fact, the second piece I'm going to show an extract from is originally a two-screen film. Made films projected onto my chest, film projected on the ceiling, and this first piece that I'm going to do, which is a little performance piece. So in relation to this one, which is called Point Source, I noticed one day how the perspective of shadows of objects projected from a small light source is like looking at the objects from the point of view of the light. So when you project shadows, it's almost like you put your head where the light bulb is, and that's the perspective that you see. So this first piece, in fact, what happens is that the light is, in relation to film, the light is both the camera and the projector at the same time. Not sure how well it's going to work in here. It's kind of, the idea is that you project all around on the ceiling, the fan, everything, so we'll get around. I just need to stop. Thank you. So then I had the idea, I thought thought, well, if I film the reflection in the hemispherical mirror and then project that back onto the hemispherical mirror, it'll basically recreate where I was. Like an anamorphic system. Like in anamorphic filmmaking, you compress the image from the sides by 2:1 and then you open it out again in projection. So that's how CinemaScope is done. So this is a different, it's another kind of anamorphic, if you like, where the image is put onto this, made into this kind of spherical image, which is then unpicked to be projected all around. So I started filming these images in a hemispherical mirror and projecting them on. And again, I still had these problems with Super 8. Quite difficult. We're talking about a long time ago now, in terms of doing stuff, so there wasn't video projection and that sort of thing. Anyway, so I couldn't make it work. I couldn't make this idea work of the all-round film projection. But what happened was I kind of got seduced by these little round images from the mirror filming, and I decided to make a short film using those images. Which is really, it's the angle of view you get is about 300 degrees. And so basically, you're altering your angle of eye view from 180 or so, just about getting out, right the way around. So the idea really with the film, which I to see, which was a two-screen film, was to explore familiar environments, only, you know, changing this perception so that we've got much more angle of view. And that's how I think the thing sort of worked in relation to, you see something, it's familiar, fairly familiar sort of environment, but through this distorted is a kind of odd word, it's a very relative thing. So I'll just show you an extract.
Thank you.
So I'm going to go into another film now, because much later on I came back to this idea of trying to do this all-round projection, and I did make an installation of the workshop. But the next piece actually is created some of the material that I later used in the installation. And because of my interest in space and orientation, which I don't know where that's come from, but I've always been fascinated by gravity and space and our sort of perception of space. I like the idea of making a film underwater. And I got the opportunity to apply for a commission with Channel 4 when they were commissioning some experiments and film and video artists' work. And I put forward this idea, which meant I got a small budget to make this film. So basically, I'm experimenting with ways with people, really, just to see people and playing around with orientation and where the surface is and where they are in relation to the surface, and discovering a few things on the way.
Yeah.
We don't seem to have it. Okay. More sound, please. Two different versions of the installation. I mean, the thing when you do installations is that every time you install it, it kind of comes out a bit different because you're in a different place. In basically what the setup is, if I just do that, pause it a second. It's a gallery, a white gallery wall, and there's behind the wall, there's a small hole in the wall, and the projector is behind the wall, projecting through. I have to use another lens or a flip there onto the mirror, and that's the setup, basically. It can be difficult in some galleries where there's solid walls, and I've had to make, what I do is make a corner, cut off the corner and make a face in the corner, and that works quite well. So some of the shots you'll see are... something about when you make make these kind of installations that they that you can change, you know, you come to set up again, give some more ideas. It becomes an evolving thing, so it's a bit different every time. The spaces are obviously different, but also the content can develop as well. I just thought it might be, you know, just an interesting thing to come from the shadow thing through the light bulb film to this realisation of this piece. Okay, so I'm going to move on to some different ideas now. Very early on, I kind of noticed what a brilliant medium film is for seeing in ways that you can't normally see, which is generally against the way that most films are made. That what is the film? It's kind of invisible onlooker, or sometimes it's point of view, which again is anthropomorphic. So I was very interested in the ways of seeing the perceptions that you could create using film, which are impossible in any other way, really. So the first... first piece is called Downsider, and I was making some experiments with orientation, and I made a falling over slowly machine, so you could just fall down really slowly. It's being used actually in a theatrical production somewhere. And I was filming someone falling over in the landscape, and I tilting the camera and lining up the sort of pivot of the tripod and the thing. So someone's standing in a landscape, and the landscape can go around them, you know. And then I thought, well, maybe it could be interesting if they fell over backwards, but then the camera's got to go up in the air like this. So I made a device which is basically two long poles with some pegged pivots in the ground, and I could just lift this thing up with my camera on it and film some test trying out this movement then. Quite liked it, and then years later I thought, well, that kind of, I think I could develop a film just with that movement, and I sort of put the falling over thing to one side really. I never filmed the guy falling over at the time. So I got a little bit of funding from one of these art places, and I built a better version of this, of a crane that was making the camera movements in this particular movement. And then I started filming Downsider, and I was not sure what the content was going to be. And in the end, I was just thinking back to the film To See that I made, which really used my family and my kids, the local environment and so on. So Downsider is a kind of home movie in a way. You know, the people in it and the places in it are all where I was at the time in my young kids. The dog has puppies there in it, and visitors come there in it. But because of the nature of the movement, I decided to edit it so that every shot is a scene. You know? So you make a continuous 180-degree move, and that's a scene, and then you come out somewhere else. So you've got this, well, let's have a look at it. This is a cut down version of it. Hopefully we get the same point. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. good. I don't know what's going on in the south, sorry.
But it's not so bad, actually.
Huh?
It's not so bad.
Not so bad?
No.
Maybe it's a
we'll actually move on that one as we go. Okay. Downside up this kind of different sort of relationship with the ground and gravity and things I like about the kind of, you're getting this voyeuristic view, but at the same time it's mechanical, so and the voyeuristic side of it implies a sort of anthropomorphic and subjectiveness, but the fact it's just giving you this mechanical thing like that. This next one, I'm going to put this because it has a strange relationship to downside up. In the, when I was making downside up, a colleague, his girlfriend, was just studying film in another college where I was working, and he told me about this film, what was going on in this film, and she put a camera on a tripod, sort of looking down the tripod, and was riding around on a bicycle, holding this camera on a tripod, swinging it around like this, over her head. And then he came back and told me this story about his girlfriend doing this with the Super 8 camera on it, and twisting it around over his head, her head. And it was looking down the tripod. He told me about it. I didn't see anything. And I was like, oh, camera trapped stuff on the tripod looking down. I think I'm interested in that and how that might look. And I did tried out some things with it, which eventually led to making this sort of 1 minute film. Called Holding the Viewer, where basically I've got the camera on a pole, and the performer is going around, bringing it up above his head, and swinging it down. I made it for, there was a culture program with the Late Show years ago, they were commissioning 1 minute films from people, so it was made for there, for that. And as well as the guy with the camera, it's holding the viewer, so he's holding you lot really in his hand, moving it around. And I also got the idea, I don't know how you can hear it that well, but to put on some sound, like the sound from the audience, so a bit like the sound of people at the fairground or something. We're going up and we're dropping down. Anyway.
Rat, you're coming with me.
Another sort of perceptual kind of experiment, if you like. I found an anamorphic lens, which I've heard of an anamorphic system before, which squashes the image when you look through it. Things are squashed by a factor of 2 to 1, so it's more as it should be. And I experimented with it on the Super 8 camera, so I put it on the Super 8 camera and filmed stuff, and then I edited it. And sometimes it was making things very tall, sometimes it was making things very wide. And I edited it so that half of the film was one way and half the other way. And then I put the lens on the projector as well. So it made half of the film a sort of almost like a square screen and the other one like a cinemascope. And later on I developed it on 16mm and made this film a movie, which, similar to some of the other films, it's okay if your eyesight, if everything is changed in dimension by a factor of 4, what's the world of, you know, how does movement work and how do things look? So that's what I was doing with this one, again, using kind of familiar environments and kids and so on, again. Person crew doing all the sound and editing, doing everything. carried on for a little bit so I have some help with editing. And there was a kind of storyboard for holding the viewer because it's just a 1 minute thing, so it needed to be sort of defined fairly well. But anything else, there's no script, and you know, so I have a kind of fairly clear idea basically what I'm trying to kind of look for, and then evolving and shoot stuff a bit and keep, you know, just filming and looking back. And also usually I had some idea about how long the piece would be, you know, how big is this idea in terms of time really. Anyway, Laws of Nature is also a little bit different in that these other films basically sort of mostly apart from Waterwork use one sort of idea of how the perception of being changed. Laws of Nature is sort of experimental landscape film where I'm just looking at lots of different ways to film landscape. And I also did start to use music as well. I worked with a singer and a recorder player, and they were improvising to some of the shots that I made. Because going through for many years, I was making these films with no dialogue, no script, no story, and no music. You kind of tell people, "What's perhaps going to be?" You know. Anyway, so I was gradually moving on to still no dialogue here. Anyway, if I've got time to show a couple more.
Yeah.
This is about 5 minutes. It's a 25-minute film. mean, that, some of the it's 25 minutes, the first 10 minutes the camera is always on locked off on the tripod. And I'm thinking about how do we relate to landscape. So there is a sequence, touching, looking, listening, walking, basically. So that's kind of the first part of the film, you're touching, looking, listening, walking. And then there's the whole movement stuff going on. Can I show one more?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, 5 minutes. Just some local Romans. It's a place that, North Cross, there you go. This was a little collaboration with, there's an audio collective in Plymouth called Cafe Concrete. I'm not sure if it's still going, but
yes, it is.
It is?
It is.
Members
yeah.
here?
Yes.
Okay, great. Anyway, so they had this idea to bring together filmmakers and sound artists and make a whole load of pieces about different places in Plymouth and buildings or whatever. And I decided to use North Cross, the roundabout North Cross, which you probably all know if you're aware of. But partly because I walk through it very often and I like the sort of separation of the people and the traffic. And I used it as a kind of way, as an experiment with fairly simple things, but just to do with digital editing. I mean, actually, Laws of Nature edited on digital stuff. Everything else back there is all Steam Deck bits of film, tape and stuff. Okay, I'll show you this. Sound seems to be a bit better than that. Does it sound now? Mm-hmm. Good sound as well.
Thank you.
I just wrote a note to myself at the end, was the experiment successful? More search than research, maybe.
I don't know what, if we have time for just a couple of
questions. Yes, I was going to go.
Yes, I don't know what time is.
Sorry about the sound hiccups.
So you spoke a lot in between about how you produce the various different images, but you didn't speak too much about the sound. The sound's obviously quite important, so I just wondered if you had anything particular you wanted to say about that. And in particular, I think the thing that I noticed watching it is the fact that the ambient sound is obviously very prominent in a lot of times, as you think about bird song. So I just wondered, you know, what your intention was with that.
Yeah, the sound is very important. Yes. I was getting very nervous here, but the sound, different things happening. The first thing I showed you with the spherical images, I actually collaborated with somebody who made this sort of pentatonic sound with it. It's quite funny actually, because I suggested that he collaborate. He was actually the partner of one of my students years ago, and he started filming and showing him stuff, and he started producing this kind of disco music stuff. No, this isn't what I meant at all. I thought I explained it. What I wanted was, you know, a sound for the sun when it comes in. Have the sound sort of coming from the image. So, you know, he made this sort of little bell sound that comes when the sun comes in, and a sound for the blink. He said, I've figured out how to do a blink. You can hit your chest and go, or something. He recorded it. And there was a whole sequence at the end where any bits of it where the whole thing's going over and over, where you have two ladders sort of tied together with speakers on the end, and sounds that he'd made coming out of the speakers, and then a dummy head, you know, all about the sound stuff, and he just rotated this thing with the sounds and they came by. He loved, you know, he was really experimental with that, and that was great. Waterwork, yeah, I mean, that was all shot mute. It's hard to record sound in a swimming pool. They've got these pumps going all the time. And then I got this amazing, didn't quite hear all of it, but the amazing image of the guy blowing the bubbles. And I thought, how am I going to get that? So where I was living, I'd built a reservoir for the water because the water always ran out in the summer. And I had a welding kit, and I put a bit of hose pipe down to the bottom of the reservoir, put a balloon on a microphone, stuck it in the water, and then I had a video, I copied it onto video. We had a video there, great, I could see video of the thing, and then every time the bubble came, I just opened the valve, you know, and that's where, how I made the sound. I mean, filmmaking is kind of so much about invention all the time, and that's the part that I enjoy as well. Also, like I say, there's a lot of bird sounds in the outside. Not quite sure why.
Well, it kind of made me feel a particular way watching it. Like you said, you made a point about it being like voyeurism, but on a kind of mechanical track. And it felt to me like there was a certain restriction there. So particularly, there's quite a long scene with the picnic.
Yeah.
And it kind of felt like you were observing these people and you wanted to get close to them, and you couldn't hear them really, because all you could hear was this person was going on, and the conversation was very, very muffled. So it felt a bit like both this vision and the sound made me feel like I couldn't get as close as I wanted to.
Yeah. And it's about the movie again, that was all shot mute, and, you know, the sound stuff on, building the sound. Yeah, I mean, it's as much about the sound as about the image, really, in a lot of ways.
So, could you explain what the contraption was for downside up? Is it like an inverted L shape? Because you couldn't see on either side where it's coming from. Or is that a trade secret?
No, yeah. if you look on my website, there's a little thing about it. It's a very simple. I might picture it. In
It does look magical. Where is it?
Where's the camera? And it's kind of, it seems perfectly sort of spherical.
Yeah.
That's
that's a big version. I made my one that I made downside up with, and then later on, much later on, I started made some TV commercials, which I've shown in another context here. And we designed this a bigger version. Basically, say it's a there's an axle here with a couple of bearings, and this is welded to the axle. And then there are springs coming down to this kind of lever arm on the axle. And there's an operating thing, and you can just, the springs balance the weight of this, of the beam and the camera. So you can just do it by hand. That's what it is. There's a bit more on my website.
It's a bit more complex than what I was saying.
So basically, the angle of this is designed around a particular lens angle. So, in fact, it's 25 degrees. So, if the camera's looking straight down, you know, this is everything here is just out of shot. That kind of goes off at an angle there. So, when it's down on the floor, that side, everything here is just out of shot.
Did you see that you had to, the camera was coming out of the earth?
Yeah.
Did you have to dig?
Yeah. Yeah, no, well, you just have to be inventive.
Or someone else is that.
A little bit of black velvet.
What did the family think of all this going on?
Sorry?
What did the family think of your...
I think it probably drove them a bit nuts, somewhere in a film that episode. Yeah, it was a bit crazy. And then it took me ages to finish the sound as well, aspect of it, because of constructing a lot of it later on. There was some sync sound in the film. Because syncs, filmmakers will know, in the old days, sync sound was like, oh, we're going to have sync sound. What, we need a special camera that doesn't make a noise. And, I mean, it just seems so ancient now. You get your video camera or your phone. You can film, you get sync sound as well. Although, having said that, I've taught filmmaking for years, and unless students start, you know, ideally I would give them the camera that won't record sound, start with, and a sound recorder, and right, you construct the sound, and you construct the images, and people who don't do that will get the opportunity to do that really. Never kind of get that relationship, I don't think, in terms of construction. You know, constructing the sound for the audience. Anyone else?
Yeah, you said you trained as an architect. Do you consciously use architectural principles for your work?
What do you mean?
I don't know what I mean.
What's an architectural principle?
I don't know. Things you were trained in.
Sorry?
Architecturally.
Well, first year of architecture when I did it was like a foundation course, you know, you're doing structures and colour and stuff like that. I've just always had this interest in space and orientation, like I said, and making things.
Perhaps to ask a similar question, just what you said before, nothing seems really... The construction of sound image is very powerful, and not only was 1635 mil too expensive, but it's very obvious that you apply a great deal of knowledge of physics and optics. How did you acquire that? Does it seem to you prior training, or
are
you just constantly engaged with the technology?
Well, physics. I like physics at school as well. So, you know, things like total internal reflection under the water and all that sort of stuff. Yeah. And optics to a certain extent. Geometry was an interest. So, and then people rolling around in the thing and shot them downside up. That was a sort of
geometric shape thing that I kind of discovered. And so, sorry, I forgot what your question was now. Physics. Well, I know, I haven't done any special studying of physics. You discover things doing it, really. I mean, the installation that I showed a sort of documentary bit of, where it's projected onto the hemispherical mirror, is a really odd thing which I don't understand, but physicists will probably know. But actually, you project the image onto the mirror, and you focus it on the mirror, and then it's in focus no matter how far away the walls are, which works so well for that. You know, you've got a square room or whatever, doesn't matter that it's quite a lot further to that corner to the middle there, it still stays in focus. I mean, I have no idea why it does that. It does. You actually focus it on the mirror itself. Someone can tell me.
Have you considered doing the installation again with multiple projectors and creating a kind of an environment? But I just found it very compelling. And kind of along the lines of what is being asked, while watching you perform, I was thinking, oh, that's really interesting, but I can see them, how the imperfection of the human body creates these jerkiness and movement. I wish, you know, maybe you could build something to control, and it's like, oh, there you go. That was a comment.
Was that a
comment? You know the shapes that you chose for the light show?
Yeah.
Did you choose them for a particular reason, like to evoke a particular feeling in people? Because personally, I really liked the geometric cube. The basket kind of made me feel a bit uneasy.
Well, the geometric cube, actually, when I first did it, I didn't have that, and I made that a bit later because I, you know, just that sort of structural cubic division of space kind of seemed like it would work quite well. That is the original basket, which has nearly died after 41 years. The basket, of course, like I was saying about the projection all around, you're cutting off most of the light, so you've got small areas of light in predominantly darkness again, so that sort of intensifies the kind of experience of the shadows, I think. But there's no ulterior motive behind putting in the basket. I don't know how well it worked in here. It's kind of tricky space.
I thought it really made immersive vision theaters redundant. I mean, the quality of immersion was spatial. It was not just all the screen surface, but it was spatial space.
Yeah, someone said it looked 3D. Yeah. Why do we need 3D? Good.
Okay, Tony, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.